GCSE results day. What schools don't tell you. So today is the day that 2 to 3 years of work has culminated in. A sealed envelope with a series of letters and numbers that decide your future for the next few years. It might come as a shock or a surprise to see how well you've done, and now you're racing off to confirm your place wherever you're going. I've seen those faces of glee and gloom over the many years teaching in schools, colleges and universities. And what I can tell you is that many students make the mistake of being bullied or even pushed onto the wrong courses. So, follow the book, Philip's Guide to Results Day, and remember what it says on the back cover. The words, "Don't panic," printed in large, friendly letters. Okay, you've got your piece of paper which indicates what you want to do in the future. Now, to get from here to there might seem straightforward, according to your teachers. But in reality, there are many routes. So, what are the routes? One, stay where you are and continue in the sixth form, A-levels, BTEC, or other. Number two, move to another school's sixth form. Yes, you should have applied earlier, but many students are changing their plans, so there are usually some places if you act promptly. Three, go to college. Or four, join an apprenticeship scheme. Doing A-levels at sixth form or sixth form college often sounds like a natural next step after GCSEs, but it may not always be the best option for what you want. Now, something the school hasn't told you is that they get paid for every student that comes through their doors. This applies to every institution, but it gets worse. Your school wants you, or in reality, the money that's associated with you. Let's take a class of 26 students in a school. The school gets all the money. However, if two schools share the same course, or class, they get 13 students each, and they get half as much money. And that's half as much money for the school. Schools get different amounts of money depending on the subjects you take. Maths is worth more. Colleges aren't paid in the same way. They get paid money allocated not really depending on the number of students in a class, but number of students overall. Your school wants to keep the status quo, as they expect you to also keep the status quo. The school expects you to have the same attitude you've always had. And this is what most students do. They tend to stay in the same school, fearing change, fearing losing friends. Remember, you have the power. Don't do what your school needs you to do. Do what you need. It's your life, your career. It's your school. If your school won't let you do because, ooh, it's in the wrong block, or we don't do that, you'd do better off taking this or that, then another sixth form in another school might be your best option. You're worth a lot of money to the school, several thousands of pounds, and all they're doing is trying to get your bum on their seats. Some schools say that you can only do A-levels if you've got this particular grade, or some departments only take students with 8s or 9s. It's not that you have to you've got a 6 and you can't do the course. It's because the school only cares about its reputation of having all our students got an A at A level. And that's because they only took the brightest. You need to look after number one. Just because you're good at something at GCSE doesn't mean that it's the best choice for going on to A levels. I remember a girl choosing maths and Spanish because they were her best subjects. And it was fine until she wanted to go to uni. And then her choice was very limited. If you want to go to university later, then choose A-levels that go well together. Look at university courses to see what they require. So, let's say that a different sixth form has everything you need and that they're willing to accept you. Wouldn't. But you're worried about what it's going to be like. A thing that might surprise you is that students generally do better with this option. And the reason is simple. All that baggage from your old school, such as your old teacher's perception of you, and their assumptions, they're gone. It's a blank slate. This means that the new teachers only see post-GCSE you. Not the you from 5 years ago, or how you've changed over 5 years of schooling. And if you're worried about fitting into the new crowd, well, those students are also trying to do the same thing. And just think about the new people you're going to meet. But they'll be in a different school. What happens when I don't do so well and the school throws me out to go on to, well, they can't. Not on grades or performance. I know of schools who, after 1 year doing A-levels, ask the students to leave as their grades are not good enough to pass. And these are often students just getting D's, E's or F's in a test. The school can ask, but you don't have to leave. You have to stay in full-time education until you're 18, so they have to keep you. They ask you not to continue the A-level courses because of, well, their reputation. Remember, at A-levels, A, B, C, D and E are all passes. You won't or you can't improve. Well, most of my students do work hard. And they do improve. I've taken students who have been rejects and failures. I've coached them and tutored them. And they do improve. And they do get the grades. And they do go on to uni. Colleges. This seems an unattractive option at first, but it really shouldn't. If schools are sandwiches, then colleges are flatbed wraps. The same filling, just presented differently. Now, you might have been told that GCSEs lead on to A-levels, but they aren't the only way you can get qualifications after GCSEs. Many places offer vocational qualifications. These are still study courses, just like A-levels, and they give you important qualifications that employers will recognise, just like A-levels. The difference is that you're less likely to be in a classroom all day, every day. Typical courses I've taught were 3 days a week, and the other 4 days, you had to work, but you could manage a part-time job. You'll apply your learning to practical, real-life situations. Vocational qualifications can really help you get ahead in life and work. But that doesn't mean that they're easier. Just different. The basic difference between schools and colleges is that a school treats their sixth formers as children, and colleges treat their students as adults. Now, these vocational qualifications, they get a bad rap due to the students who, well, they don't go there. Because they're designed for students with less ambitious academic careers, and it's treated as a lifeline rather than as a choice. But many of my students stayed with me at college for many years, going from a BTEC level 2 to a BTEC level 3, then on to an HND, then to a top-up course, giving them a full degree. And they came out with better grades and jobs than many students who did well at A-level. So now, let's look at the final option, an apprenticeship or traineeship. This is what most people think of, is how to become an electrician or a plumber. The more service-based jobs. But you can go through an apprenticeship to become a lawyer. Because apprenticeships aren't what most people think of them. They're in fact a sort of inverse of the vocational study at college. Vocational study allows for a part-time job, but an apprenticeship allows for part-time studying. These are supported by employers and the government. You get paid, and it allows you to get into the workplace sooner and get ahead of the pack in terms of salary, transferable skills, which are in high demand. So remember, don't panic. Think carefully about your options. It isn't too late, despite what some teachers will say. You're in control, so go ahead and take control of your life and your destiny. Good luck.